Well, let's now get you the latest on the vaccination drive against coronavirus. Over 17,000 people were vaccinated across 553 sites in six states on day two of India's vaccination drive. That's yesterday. The Health Ministry has said that 447 adverse events have been reported so far. And the government has also now released a schedule for vaccination for all the states. All major states will vaccinate on 4 days of every week, while smaller states like Goa will vaccinate on 2 days of every week. Now, if we talk about the adverse effects, the Delhi government has said that there have been 51 cases of minor complications reported from coronavirus vaccine that was rolled out. In Delhi, 4,319 healthcare workers vaccinated on the first day, among which one slightly serious case was reported. The patient was admitted to AIIMS and is stable now. A 22-year-old security guard who works at the hospital, he was admitted in the hospital's intensive care unit. Well, let's go across to Sukirti for more. So, Sukirti, first and foremost, the adverse events are also being talked about by the ministry. They're saying none of them were very serious, except the Delhi one did have the person being admitted to ICU in AIIMS, also a schedule for all states.
So, as far as the adverse events front is concerned, there was a health ministry press conference last evening where they gave the overall picture as well, where they said that out of the 2.24 lakh people that have been vaccinated in India so far, there have been 447 cases of adverse events, out of which there have been only three hospitalizations. Out of those three, one is the security guard in AIIMS. The other one was a person at the railway hospital in Delhi. Both of these people have been discharged, both these cases in Delhi. There's another third hospitalization which took place in AIIMS Rishikesh. That person is still under observation. Until last evening, that was the update. So only three hospitalizations, total of 447 adverse events so far. That's the update from the health ministry. As far as the schedule is concerned, the ministry yesterday declared that all the states were requested that the vaccinations should be conducted on any 4 days of the week so that the routine health services are not affected. And states have chosen those 4 days based on whatever suits them. Most of the major states will be carrying it out on 4 days of the week. Some smaller states like Goa will carry it on only 2 days of the week because they have much lesser number of people to vaccinate. UP is the only exception that has decided to conduct vaccinations on only 2 days of the week. They have a much larger target of vaccine beneficiaries, but unclear at this point why they have chosen only 2 days.
All right, Sukirti, thanks so much for joining us with those details. So only 64% of the vaccination target was achieved on day one, but the government expects the numbers will improve going into this week. And as Sukirti was saying, 447 adverse events have been reported so far. Here's a report.
Only 64% of the vaccination target achieved on day one, but the government expects the numbers will improve next week and claims it was the highest day one vaccinations in the world.
Highest day one vaccination number in the world. मैं आपको बताना चाहता हूँ कि ये संख्या किसी भी एक दिन में किसी भी देश में सर्वाधिक है, higher than USA, UK and France on day one.
Among major states, Maharashtra had a target of vaccinating 28,000 people on the first day, but about 18,000 people received the vaccine. Andhra Pradesh had a target of vaccinating over 33,000 healthcare workers, but vaccinated over 18,000 of them. In UP, around 21,000 healthcare workers were vaccinated against a target of 37,000.
Reaching 62% is a really good turnout according to me.
We took a decision that we will do only 30 as a first day at each of the 140 locations. If the doctors at senior level, if they take the vaccine, and they give a statement or it is just put to knowledge of people, I think that builds a lot of confidence.
Delhi had planned to vaccinate 8,117 people, but the actual vaccinations were 4,319, out of which there were 51 cases of minor adverse events or side effects and one severe adverse event. A 22-year-old security guard of AIIMS who had to be hospitalized but is stable now.
लास्ट मोमेंट के ऊपर वो टर्न अप नहीं हुए जो वैक्सीनेशन है प्योरली वॉलंटरी है कंपलसरी नहीं है तो जो लगवाने वाला है उसकी पूरी छूट है कि वो लगवाए या ना लगवाए
बट व्हाट आर एडवर्स इवेंट्स An adverse event following immunization or AEFI is any untoward medical occurrence which follows immunization and which does not necessarily have a causal relationship with the usage of the vaccine. The adverse event may be any unfavorable or unintended disease or symptom. These are categorized as minor, severe or serious. The Congress today targeted the government over the cost of the vaccine.
Will the members of scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, backward classes, below poverty line, above poverty line, poor and underprivileged, get free corona vaccine or not? And the Belgium minister, on the other hand, said that the AstraZeneca vaccine is costing them euro 1.78 or 158 rupees. So question is, why is Modi government then paying rupees 200 for the AstraZeneca vaccine when they themselves are saying that they are supplying it at no profit?
Union Health Minister Dr. Harshvardhan had earlier said that the vaccines will be free for the first 1 crore healthcare workers and 2 crore frontline workers. The modalities of the cost of the vaccine for the general public are still being worked out. In New Delhi, this is Sukirti Dwivedi for NDTV.
And Union Health Minister Dr. Harshvardhan will meet with the Serum Institute of India and Bharat Biotech representatives as well as MEA officials today over the issue of export of COVID vaccines. According to reports, India plans to offer 20 million doses of coronavirus vaccine to its neighbours. It is drawing up a policy to supply vials to countries across the globe. A parliamentary committee has summoned officials of Facebook and Twitter to discuss the issue of safeguarding citizens' rights, preventing misuse of social news media platforms and women's security in the digital space. This meeting will be held on the 21st of January. The summons from the Standing Committee on Information and Technology came amid a huge row over data privacy. Now, some disturbing news from Madhya Pradesh. A 13-year-old girl was kidnapped and gang-raped by 9 men in Madhya Pradesh's Umaria district thrice within 5 days, according to the police. At least 4 such chilling incidents in the last 6 days against women in various parts of the state have raised questions about their safety.
A 13-year-old girl gang-raped thrice by 9 men, passed on by truck driver to truck driver in MP's Umaria district. The horror and physical trauma has shocked her to the point of speechlessness.
6 आरोपी हिरासत में ले लिए गए हैं, एक की तलाश की जा रही है और इसमें पॉक्सो एक्ट भी लगी हुई है. पॉक्सो एक्ट यदि नाबालिग लड़की के साथ कोई अपचारी अपराध करता है तो उसके लिए पॉक्सो एक्ट लगती है.
The horrifying incident comes at a time when the Shivraj Singh Chauhan government is running the Samman campaign, a fortnight-long public awareness drive about crime against women across the state. But 4 ghastly incidents have raised some serious questions about the safety of women in the state. On January 9th, a 48-year-old woman was raped by a man with the help of 4 others inside her hut in Sidi district. The main accused in the case also allegedly inserted an iron rod in the private parts of the woman. 2 days later, on January 11th, a 13-year-old girl was kidnapped by her neighbor, who then allegedly raped the teenager and murdered her in Khandwa district. A day later, a young woman was assaulted by her husband and father-in-law, suspecting her of infidelity in Ujjain district. The accused men, along with women of the family, used sharp-edged weapons to cut the woman's nose, breast and also injured parts of her body. With Bureau Inputs in Bhopal, Anurag Dwari for NDTV.
Now, several farm leaders protesting against the 3 farm laws, a Punjab-based journalist and an actor are among 40 people who have now been summoned as witnesses for questioning by the National Investigative Agency in connection with a case registered against Sikhs for Justice, a secessionist group based outside of India. They have been called between the 17th and 20th of January after being served notices under Section 160 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, which empowers a police officer to call a witness to join an ongoing investigation.
Gearing up for a tractor parade on Republic Day, with tractors moving from Punjab towards the Delhi-Haryana border every day.
26 जनवरी को किसान गणतंत्र परेड का आयोजन दिल्ली के भीतर किया जाएगा. यह परेड आउटर रिंग रोड की परिक्रमा कर आयोजित की जाएगी। यह परेड पूरी तरह से शांतिपूर्ण रहेगी।
But ahead of this tractor parade, around 40 people, mostly involved in the farm agitation, have been summoned by the NIA to join investigation in a case of terror funding. But leaders like Baldev Singh Sirsa, a farm union leader who is part of the ongoing negotiation with the government, says it is a way to harass agitating farmers.
सरकार वालों साढ़े लोकां दे उते एक दबाव पाउण वास्ते जिहड़े कि असी एक खेती विरोधी जिहड़े कानून बनाए गए सन उन्हां दे विरुद्ध लंबे समय तो एजिटेशन कर रहे हैं।
NIA's FIR is against three individuals based in US, UK and Canada accused of collecting funds for an alleged rebellion against the government of India under the Sikhs for Justice banner. Farm union leader like Baldev Sirsa, actor Deep Sidhu and many others have received summons to join the investigation. Deep Sidhu and Baldev Sirsa have refused to join the probe. Farm union leaders protesting near the Delhi-Haryana border says the government is displaying signs of nervousness.
ये NIA नहीं कर रही, ये वो सरकार कर रही जो किसी रोज बोलती थी कि हमारी 56 इंच की छाती है, आज उनकी छाती सुकड़कर छोटी हो गई, आज हृदय छोटा हो गया नरेंद्र मोदी का, आज कमजोर हो गए किसानों के आंदोलन के आगे।
Even the Akali Dal have criticized the union government for these summons.
सेंटर सरकार विच फ्रस्ट्रेशन आ गई, वो सोचते सी किसानों की जिहड़ी संघर्ष है वो कमजोर हो जूगा, खत्म हो जूगा, पर उन्होंने देखा जिन्ना लेट करी जाते हैं उन्ना तगड़ा संघर्ष हो जाते हैं, आ सारा कुछ अंडर फ्रस्ट्रेशन कर रहे हैं ते श्रोमणी अकाली दल स्ट्रॉन्गली कंडेम कर रही है।
The farm unions have decided to hold tractor parade inside the national capital on the outer ring road, which still awaits due permission from the Delhi police. Now it is yet to be seen whether summons from NIA will deter protesters from participating in the tractor parade. With Mukesh Singh Sengur in Delhi, Mohammad Ghazali in Chandigarh, Revati Hariharan for NDTV.
Time for us to slip into a short break. On the other side, the Shiv Sena will contest in the Bengal elections. We'll get you the details. Back, the Shiv Sena will contest the assembly elections in West Bengal due later this year. The party's Sanjay Raut announced on Sunday, jutting into the high-pitched contest between Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee's Trinamool Congress and a surging BJP. He said, so here is the much-awaited update. After discussions with the party chief, Uddhav Thackeray, Shiv Sena has decided to contest the West Bengal assembly elections. This is what he declared yesterday and tweeted. Earlier, we spoke to Purva for more details.
Shiv Sena MP Sanjay Raut has tweeted saying that Shiv Sena is ready to contest in the West Bengal Assembly elections scheduled for early this year. In fact, he also said that after consulting with Shiv Sena Chief Uddhav Thackeray, they have decided that they will be contesting the West Bengal elections. However, he did not say how many seats they will be contesting, whether they will be joining hands with any party or not. Those details he has not yet said. But this is something that needs to be seen as to how many seats Shiv Sena will contest, because even in, this is not the first time that Shiv Sena will be going into West Bengal. In fact, earlier in 2019 during Lok Sabha election, Shiv Sena had contested from some of the seats in West Bengal, but at that time they were a part of the NDA. So this time around, they are not a part of the NDA. In fact, they are a part of a Congress government here. They are in alliance with Congress. So whether they will be joining hands with Congress or not, that is also something that needs to be seen. In fact, in 2016 West Bengal elections, assembly elections as well, Shiv Sena had contested from 18 seats but did not win on any of those seats. It did not make any impact. So this time around, it needs to be seen whether Shiv Sena will be able to make any impact in these elections or not. In fact, Shiv Sena had just recently contested from the Bihar elections as well. So this time around, after Bihar election, now they are saying that they are fighting even in the West Bengal election, just hints that how Shiv Sena wants to expand its presence nationally as well and just not restrict itself to a regional party. And And that is why Shiv Sena is now decided that they are also going to contest the West Bengal elections. However, how many seats they will be contesting, that is something that needs to be seen. Whether they will also be joining hands with any party or they will be fighting independently, that is also something that needs to be seen.
He is an ardent fan of Prime Minister Narendra Modi. He even interviewed the Prime Minister. And now actor Akshay Kumar is urging fans and followers to make contributions for the construction of the Ram Temple in Ayodhya. He shot a video at his house where he narrates a tale from Hindu epic Ramayana to inspire his fans to make these donations. And he also says, I'm sure you will join me too, so that generations that will come after us will be inspired to follow life lessons that the righteous Lord Ram taught us. With that, time for us to slip into a short break. Coming up on the other side, we'll take a look at the weather forecast for North India. Well, let's now take a look at the cold wave conditions across North India, and temperatures drop below 5 degrees at a few places. In Delhi, the minimum temperature has dropped to 5.7 degrees. The IMD has said a cold to severe cold day in Delhi during the next 24 hours, and temperatures in Delhi likely to rise over the next 2 days is what the IMD has said. They've also said that a dense fog observed over Punjab, Haryana, Chandigarh, UP, and moderate to dense fog over Delhi and West Rajasthan. Well, to talk more about the weather, we're now joined by Brigadier Vinod Datta, Senior Consultant, National Institute of Disaster Management. Thank you so much for joining us. So this cold wave, how unusual is this cold wave conditions? It's said that there's going to be some relief soon.
Gargi, it's going, I think it will take some more time, and the spell has been rather long, though January always experiences extreme conditions. But this particular scenario is part of the La Nina conditions, and these weather conditions, they come up by cooling off of the Pacific Ocean. So the conditions have become more challenging because of triple conditions. I will not say twin disasters. I will say triple disaster. First is, people are fighting a pandemic. Second is people are fighting pollution, which is a very big challenge, and especially in NCR region, because the levels are so high. And to top it all, this cold wave is a bigger challenge. And it has impacted the transport sector, the power sector, and the underprivileged people, and of course, the senior citizens.
Right.
So this spell, we all are hoping against hopes that in a couple of days, the temperature in an acceptable range.
Right, and it's very worrying in terms of safety as well. On the highways, we're also joined by GP Sharma, President Meteorology and Climate Change at SkyMet. Sir, so what is the forecast like? When will there be some relief?
Relief, Gargi, as such, the cold wave conditions along with the cold day conditions. Like yesterday, we had a cold day. This was the second cold day for Safdarjung Observatory, recorded less than 16 degrees. Otherwise, Delhi NCR region has been having, actually, there have been a record number of cold days in this season so far, more than eight. Palam Observatory recorded more than 8 days, which is a little higher than much higher than the average. So this winter, in any case, it was expected also on account of the La Nina conditions. We can expect extended winters, harsh winters. That was the forecast also. And I don't see any immediate relief. But yes, coming this weekend, we can expect some rains for the North India, but mainly confined to hills and some foothills parts of Punjab, Haryana. I don't think Delhi will have that, but with that reversal in the winds or so and the immediate vicinity, we have some weather activity. So some scenario will change, some twist in the weather conditions will come at that time. We will get some relief from this cold wave conditions. Temperatures, minimum temperatures will rise, but then day temperature will continue to remain below normal. So I don't expect any immediate relief. Nowadays, main problem is fog. Actually, what we see nowadays, even today in Delhi, it's a lifted fog, uplift fog. It's a sky obscured. You can't see anything above. okay, but fortunately it's not on ground, so horizontal visibility is okay. I think the flights may not get affected with this, but it is a fog which is restricting the rise in the temperature, day temperature. Sunshine is very restricted. We hardly saw anything in the last 3 days, and that's what the not allowing the temperatures, day temperatures, to rise. Yesterday was the second coldest day with 15.3 was the maximum at Safdarjung. Earlier, 17 December, we had 15.2. So this is going to continue. I don't see any immediate relief as such, Gagi. Yes.
Right. And Brigadier Vinod Dutta, if we talk about safety, that's a big concern, as both of you have raised concerns regarding the fog during this period.
Yeah, the safety conditions are of great concern, because the dense fog and this cold wave is going to impact, as I told you, the transport, whether it is surface transport, air transport, and even the power sector, because the power consumption has become very, very high. And as it is in the domestic sector, the power consumption is, skyrocketing, because people are working from home and, they want these heating appliances. And thirdly, the underprivileged people, you see, people who are staying in night shelters or who are spending the, night on roadside or under open shelters. So they are going to face a great challenge. And keeping the pandemic, social distancing or the, conditions, people may not be able to observe. So that itself is a great challenge for the administration, because the administration has to provide heating appliances. And they also have to shift people. The shelters have to be repurposed, like what we had done for quarantine centers. Now it is incumbent on the part of administration that they should look for some other premises, like marriage halls or other such big community centers, where they can be repurposed for the underprivileged people, those who are finding it very difficult to live under such cold wave conditions. So it is, yes, it is a challenge for the administration. And yes, cold wave is a disaster-like situation.
All right. Well, thank you so much both for joining us on the program today. So cold wave conditions continuing in North India, and no real relief expected anytime too soon. Thank you for joining us. Well, news from Delhi now. In Delhi, schools are resuming for classes at 10 and 12, almost after 10 months since the lockdown, which took place in March. But it's not compulsory for all students to attend, and students can attend only with the consent of their parents. Well, let's go across to Arun Singh for more on this story. And Arun, so finally for classes 10 and 12, Delhi schools are opening today. Lots of steps in place for safety.
Definitely, Gandhi. First, this is not mandatory for students to go to the school. And those who are attending today will have to visit the school with their parents' consent only. A record will also be taken of students coming to the school, but that is not for attendance purpose, as this is absolutely voluntary. Now, again, schools which are inside containment zones are not allowed to reopen, and for now, there are around 1,400 active containment zones in Delhi. Even teachers from those containment zones are not allowed to attend the school. So that is one big relief for parents. But there will be a lot of precautions taken, as there will be frequent sanitization. Then there will be shorter classes. And again, as I said, this is not a mandatory thing. Students can choose to study from their respective houses as well. And attendance is also not mandatory. And temperature checks will also be done, Gaji.
All right, Arun, thanks so much for joining us with those details. So schools in Delhi are reopening today. Now, over 17,000 people were vaccinated across 553 sites in 6 states on day 2 of India's coronavirus vaccination drive. That was yesterday. And the Health Ministry yesterday evening said there have been 447 adverse events reported so far, but claiming that most of these events are minor, mild fever and some sort of allergic reaction. The government has also released a vaccination schedule for the states, all major major states will vaccinate on 4 days every week, while smaller states like Goa will vaccinate only on 2 days, though Uttar Pradesh has also said that they're going to be vaccinating only on 2 days. Now, if we talk about these adverse events being reported and specifically about the national capital, the Delhi government has said there have been 51 cases of minor complications reported from coronavirus vaccine that was rolled out. In Delhi, 4,319 healthcare workers were vaccinated on the first day, among which one slightly serious case was reported. The patient was admitted to AIIMS and is stable now. The patient is a 22-year-old security guard who works at the hospital. He was admitted to the hospital's intensive care unit. And what exactly are these adverse effects? This is directly related to the vaccine and what the global standards are. So far, only 64% of the vaccination target was achieved on day one, but the government expects that the situation will improve in the week to come. And as we said, 447 adverse events have been reported so far.
Only 64% of the vaccination target achieved on day one, but the government expects the numbers will improve next week and claims it was the highest day one vaccinations in the world.
Highest day one vaccination number in the world. मैं आपको बताना चाहता हूँ कि ये संख्या किसी भी एक दिन में किसी भी देश में सर्वाधिक है, higher than USA, UK and France on day one.
Among major states, Maharashtra had a target of vaccinating 28,000 people on the first day, but about 18,000 people received the vaccine. Andhra Pradesh had a target of vaccinating over 33,000 healthcare workers, but vaccinated over 18,000 of them. In UP, around 21,000 healthcare workers were vaccinated against a target of 37,000.
Reaching 62% is a really good turnout according to me.
We took a decision that we will do only 30 as a first day at each of the 140 locations. If the doctors at senior level, if they take the vaccine and they give a statement or it is just put to knowledge of people, I think that builds a lot of confidence.
Delhi had planned to vaccinate 8,117 people, but the actual vaccinations were 4,319. Out of which there were 51 cases of minor adverse events or side effects and one severe adverse event. A 22-year-old security guard of AIIMS who had to be hospitalized but is stable now.
Last moment ke upar wo turn up nahi hua hai. Jo vaccination hai purely voluntary hai, compulsory nahi hai. To jo lagwane wala hai uski puri chhoot hai ki wo lagwaye ya na lagwaye.
But what are adverse events? An adverse event following immunization or AEFI is any untoward medical occurrence which follows immunization and which does not necessarily have a causal relationship with the usage of the vaccine. The adverse event may be any unfavorable or unintended disease or symptom. These are categorized as minor, severe or serious. The Congress today targeted the government over the cost of the vaccine.
Will the members of scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, backward classes, below poverty line, above poverty line, poor and underprivileged, get free corona vaccine or not? And the Belgium minister, on the other hand, said that the AstraZeneca vaccine is costing them euro 1.78 or 158 rupees. So question is, why is Modi government then paying rupees 200 for the AstraZeneca vaccine, when they themselves are saying that they are supplying it at no profit?
Union Health Minister Dr. Harshvardhan had earlier said that the vaccines will be free for the first 1 crore healthcare workers and 2 crore frontline workers. The modalities of the cost of the vaccine for the general public are still being worked out. In New Delhi, this is Sukirti Dwivedi for NDTV.
20-month-old toddler and had a tragically short life but ended up giving a new lease of life to not one or two but five patients. The toddler, Dhanishtha's parents from Delhi's Rohini, have set a huge example by donating her heart, liver, kidneys and corneas to those in desperate need.
Babita and Ashish Kumar lost their 20-month-old baby but saved three other lives. After Dhanishtha was declared brain dead 3 days ago, her parents donated her heart, liver and kidneys.
एक ऐसा इंसिडेंट हुआ कि एक ऑल ऑफ दी सडन एक वहाँ पे केस आया कि एक मदर स्टेयर्स के पास बैठ के रो रही थी, उसका जो बच्चे का हार्ट था वो फेल हो गया। फिर हमने जब औरों के पेन को देखा ना, तो बस एक बीइंग अ मदर मुझे ऐसा लगा कि जो मेरे साथ हुआ है ना, वो जो ये मदर खड़ी हुई ना, इसके साथ ना हो।
The donation was historic as Zanishta's heart was transplanted into the youngest ever recipient. It was to this hospital that a green corridor was set up so that Zanishta's heart could be transplanted to a 5-month-old baby. The baby, born with a life-threatening heart defect, had been waiting for a heart small enough for his body, an extremely rare organ to come by. Dr. Mukesh Goyal brought the heart from Gangaram Hospital to Apollo Hospital, where the baby boy had been under his care for a month.
And likewise, the parents of this boy, who was obviously they did not know and they don't, it is very difficult for them to also think that somebody's life, when it goes, then their child will get a life. But they are equally grateful.
By law, information about the recipient is not shared with the family of the donor. Babita has made peace with this.
But agar ye hota hai ki agar pata chalta to aur zyada acha lagta.
Dhanishtha's parents hope they will inspire people to change their outlook on organ donation.
ये एक सोच थी जो हमारी फैमिली, हमारा समाज हमें सिखाता है, वही मैंने भी सीखा था। पर मैंने उस टाइम पे ये डिसीजन इसलिए लिया कि अगले जन्म का तो देखेंगे ना, मेरे बच्चे को इतनी ब्लेसिंग मिलेंगी ना कि भगवान को मजबूरी में उसको कंप्लीट करके भेजना ही होगा।
विद ज़ेवियर थॉमस, मेहर पांडे, फॉर एनडीटीवी।